Let's suppose you want to study a particular human protein. Maybe the gene has been associated with a disease, or the protein appears to be important in some cellular process you're trying to understand, or, like insulin, the protein has some important medical application. To study the properties of the protein or to use it as a therapy, you need to be able to purify large amounts of it. Rather than purify it from a natural source, in which the protein might be present in small quantities, it's usually more convenient to engineer a microorganism to make large quantities of the protein. The bacterium Escherichia coli and the yeast Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which are easy and inexpensive to grow, are commonly used for this purpose. This diagram outlines the steps you'd need to take to transfer your human gene of interest, which I'll call your favorite gene, into E. coli. I'll describe the basics of each step along the way, starting with the first, determining which tissues in the source organism express your favorite gene. You might think, why does it matter what tissues express the gene? Genes are found on chromosomes, which are present in every tissue type of the body. Why not just get the gene from the DNA found in any type of cell? The trouble is that human genes have introns, but E. coli, a bacterium, does not use introns. So the bacterium will be unable to splice out the introns to express the protein properly. Also, because of the introns, human genes can be very large. The average human gene is about 10 to 15 kilobases in length, but they can be much larger. Pieces of DNA that large can be difficult to work with. So, instead of trying to clone the DNA, it's a better strategy to clone the mature messenger RNA after the introns have been spliced out. Therefore, we want to find a tissue type in which our mRNA of interest is abundant. There are multiple ways to do that. To start, I'm going to describe northern blotting. In this procedure, you isolate all the RNA from the cell types you want to test. Then you separate the RNA by gel electrophoresis and transfer the separated RNA to a membrane. Finally, you probe the membrane with an oligonucleotide specific to your favorite gene. In principle, you could do the same steps to analyze DNA instead of RNA. If you use DNA, the method is called southern blotting, after the name of the scientist who first developed the procedure, Edwin Southern. The name northern blotting is a play on words of the original term, southern blotting. I'll briefly describe each step in turn, except the first one. We have ways of specifically isolating RNA from cells, but we're not going to worry about the details of that for this course. The RNA in your RNA prep will contain all of the messenger RNA from the cell. These mRNAs will be of different sizes. You can separate them by their size using gel electrophoresis. The principle is the same as for the SDS page technique used to separate proteins by size, except that all RNA is naturally negatively charged because of the phosphates in the backbone. Also, you can denature RNA just by running the gel at a warm temperature. You don't need to add detergent. You can use polyacrylamide to separate RNA and DNA, but often people use gels made of agarose, which is a polysaccharide. And this photo shows an agarose gel. To run an agarose gel, you put your RNA samples in individual wells at one end of the gel. You cover the gel with buffer and then apply an electric current. The negatively charged RNA will move through the gel away from the negative electrode and toward the positive electrode, with smaller pieces of DNA moving faster than larger pieces. After a length of time, the fragments will be separated on the gel based on their size. Note that you can't see RNA or DNA molecules with the naked eye on a gel. If you want to see them, you have to add a dye, such as ethidium bromide, which will bind to the nucleic acids. When you shine ultraviolet light on the dye, bound to DNA or RNA, it glows, allowing you to see the nucleic acids, as shown in this photo. But for northern blotting, you don't add any dye. Instead, you transfer the RNA from the gel onto a membrane. You take the gel with the separated RNA and lay a nitrocellulose or nylon membrane flat on top of it. Then you put the gel and membrane on a sponge sitting in a salt solution and stack some dry paper towels on top. The salt solution will move up into the paper towels by capillary action, and the RNA will move along with it out of the gel and onto the membrane. Eventually, all the RNA will be transferred onto the membrane. To see which samples contain mRNA for your favorite gene, you need to probe the membrane. To do that, you synthesize an oligonucleotide probe that is complementary to part of the mRNA for your favorite gene. I'm assuming here that we know the sequence of the mRNA because the human genome has been completely sequenced. You then add a radioactive phosphate group to the 5' end of the probe. You incubate the membrane, which has all of your RNA on it, with the probe under conditions that will allow specific annealing of the probe to its complementary sequence, but not to other RNAs. Then you wash away unbound probe and detect radioactivity on the membrane. If you can see a band in the lane, then that means that mRNA for your favorite gene is present in that sample. Here's an example northern blot of a gene called FOXP2. You can see that the signal is stronger in some tissues than in others. The membrane has been separately probed for actin, which should be present in all tissues at the same level. This is a control to see if the same amount of RNA was loaded in each lane. Another way of looking for specific mRNAs in the sample is called a microarray. This technique allows you to look for mRNA from many different genes all at the same time. On a two-dimensional surface, you attach oligonucleotides complementary to different mRNAs, each oligonucleotide in a different spot on the surface. Then you tag your RNA prep with a fluorescent dye such that each RNA should be fluorescently labeled. You incubate the surface with your RNA prep, and if a particular mRNA is present, it will bind to the oligonucleotides in the spot that corresponds to that mRNA. So each bright spot in this picture corresponds to the presence of a specific mRNA in the sample. If the mRNA is not present, then that spot remains dark. Once you have identified a tissue type that expresses your mRNA of interest, you can use that tissue as a source to make many copies of your mRNA, as I'll describe in the next video.